O wondrous love, O love, all loves excelling. One of the defining chorales from The Passion According to St. John by Johann Sebastian Bach. Combining the powerful gospel narrative of Christ's final days on earth with sacred poetry and familiar hymns of the day, the St. John Passion is one of the great treasures of Western civilization. It has touched the hearts and enriched the spirits of listeners for nearly 300 years. And how is that important to us? The great theologian Martin Luther once exclaimed, "It is more beneficial to ponder Christ's passion just once than to fast a whole year or to pray a psalm daily." Today, we begin a short series of conversations to introduce you to the St. John Passion, and I hope that when we're finished, you'll have a deeper understanding of this incredible masterpiece. And there's no better person to help us do just that than the music director of the Bach Society of St. Louis and my good friend, Dr. A. Dennis Sparger. And Dennis, let's begin by trying to understand what Luther meant.
Well, Ron, I think he was trying to emphasize how important it is to not just read or hear about Christ's passion, but to make it personal, to ponder it. Of course, when Martin Luther wrote these words, there's no way he could have imagined the powerful music that Bach would provide some 200 years later to provoke his own congregation into pondering Christ's passion. On the other hand, we can be certain that Bach was aware of Luther's advice. At the time of his death in 1750, Bach's personal library contained 112 theological works, mostly by Luther, and Bach knew his theology.
The text of the Passion is this amazing amalgamation, and we'll talk more about that shortly, but the music, the vehicle that delivers that text, the music is simply genius.
Well, Ron, that's right. While our minds are stimulated by words, we know that it's music that touches our emotions and connects with our very being. And if this can take place in a group setting, like a congregation or an audience, the experience can be so much more powerful. More than anyone, Bach knew how to use the elements of music to reach your heart as well as your mind. And nowhere is this more important than the telling of Christ's passion.
Help us with the concept of a passion. First, what are we talking about? I've heard of passion plays. What exactly is a musical passion?
Well, that's a good place to start, actually. Passion plays have been around for centuries, and some communities, like Oberammergau in Germany, are still presenting them today. The word passion refers to Christ's suffering on the cross, as well as the biblical accounts of his final days on earth. But it can also refer to the dramatic portrayal of these events. Now, Bach composed his dramatic Passion According to St. John for a Good Friday service in Leipzig. It's been described as both a conveyor of the gospel story and the starting point for reflection on it.
But the concept of setting the Passion to music, that didn't begin with Bach, did it?
No, not at all. While the Passion was a favorite subject in medieval sacred drama, some musical versions are even older. As early as the 5th century, the Passion story was set to music in plain song, what we call Gregorian chant. And for almost 1,000 years, this remained virtually unchanged. But by the beginning of the Renaissance, in the early 15th century, the musical settings began to reflect the styles of each composer and each historical period. After the Reformation, the words were translated into the vernacular, and sometime around 1525, the first Passion setting in German appears. Finally, by the 18th century, the Passion begins to resemble the form of an opera or oratorio with recitatives and arias. The evangelist, as well as Jesus, Peter, Pilate, and minor characters, were each represented by individual soloists. But groups of people, however, were represented by the chorus. A Baroque orchestra not only accompanied the voices, but reinforced the emotional drama. In fact, Bach's St. John Passion is so dramatic, some have actually staged it as an opera.
Well, that's understandable, actually, considering the dramatic nature of the work. But that drama is really inherent in the story, isn't it? In the gospel narrative and Bach's responses, This wasn't intended as a dramatic piece of performance art. This was a worship experience. Am I right?
Well, surely I can't imagine that Bach ever conceived this work as a concert piece, as it's used today. Bach composed a St. John Passion for the Vespers service on Good Friday, 1724, in Leipzig. It was his first large-scale composition in his new position at Leipzig. Now, there, the Good Friday services alternated between the two main churches, and in 1724, the service was held at St. Nicholas, which could seat 2,400 people. The next year, the Passion was presented at St. Thomas Church, but with many revisions. Bach made more revisions in 1732 and in 1749, with this final one being closer to the original version. And it included harpsichord to accompany the narration.
Mm-hmm. Can you give me a little context here? I know that Handel, Bach's contemporary, was a big star up in London during this time. There were no United States, just some British colonies. Help us understand, if you would, what the world was like in 1724.
Well, sure. Here's a name we all recognize, Benjamin Franklin. At this time, he was 17 years old, and he made his first trip to London, where he worked for a year as a journeyman printer. Immanuel Kant, the German philosopher, was born in 1724. We know the last name of Daniel Fahrenheit, who proposed a system for making thermometers and a temperature scale that bears his name. Peter the Great founded the Russian Academy of Sciences in 1724. And in London, there were over 1,000 coffee houses and not a single Starbucks.
Well, a world without Starbucks. Now, that's hard to fathom, actually. Let's get back to the text of the Passion. How does Bach present this story? What's his method in bringing this drama to the listener?
Well, basically, he presents only a portion of the action at a time, then provides us an opportunity to react, to think about what has just happened. Or to put it another way, after hearing a verse or two of scripture, we hear an aria sung by a soloist, so we can consider what this means to us personally, or we hear a chorale sung by the chorus, and through our recognition of a familiar hymn, we respond as a member of a group or congregation of people.
So it sounds like there's a lot more to the text of a Bach Passion than just the scriptures.
Well, indeed there is. There are three different sources for the text or libretto. At the core of the St. John Passion is the Holy Scriptures, taken directly from Martin Luther's translation of the Gospel of John, chapters 18 and 19. However, employing dramatic license, Bach omits a few verses, and borrowing from the Gospel of Matthew, he adds in Peter's lament over his denial, as well as the powerful earthquake at the moment of Christ's death. The scriptures are sung in recitative, a musical style developed in the 17th century that sounds a lot like talking set to music. The words are sung only once, and both the rhythm and melody follow the natural inflection of speech. The function of the recitative is to provide the action in the story, to carry the dialogue.
Well, we want to listen to one of those recitatives in just a moment, but based on what you're saying, the person telling the story, the evangelist, he must do most of the heavy lifting.
Oh, he has the biggest role in the Passion. The evangelist is a high tenor, and he sings most of the scriptures. But there are also important roles for Jesus, and then lesser roles for Pilate, Peter, and a few others that appear in St. John's account. When a group of people appear in the scriptures, for example, the high priest, or the soldiers, or the angry crowd, their words are sung by the chorus. These passages are called turba, or mob choruses. Don't worry, there won't be a test at the end.
Well, that's music to my ears, actually. Before we go on, let's hear an example of both a recitative and a turba chorus. Now, this excerpt features the evangelist, or narrator, as well as Jesus, and in the middle, the chorus that represents the mob. "Who are you looking for?" Jesus asks. And the mob cries out, "Jesus of Nazareth." And he replies, and I'm paraphrasing here, "I am he. If I'm the one you're looking for, let these other guys go." Listen to this.
Jesus spricht zu ihnen,
William Watson as the evangelist, Stephen Morshak singing the words of Jesus, along with the Bach Society Chorus and Orchestra conducted by music director Dennis Sparger. And Dennis, already early in the Passion, we have a taste of the drama that's beginning to unfold. But that's just in the gospel narrative. What other texts does Bach use?
Well, yes, there's more. The second source of texts is sacred poetry. And in this case, it was probably written by Heinrich Brachus, but carefully selected by Bach, of course. The poetry is heard in the arias or songs that are sung by one of the four soloists following each scene. The arias often include obbligato, that is, obligated or required parts for one or more solo instruments. Now, Bach carefully selected these instruments for their unique timbre or color to reinforce the emotional effect with a decorative counter melody. The purpose of each aria is to provide time for the listener to personally meditate on the gravity of what has just transpired, to ask, what does this mean to me?
Okay, let's pause there for just a moment and hear an example of one of these solo arias. Fairly early in the story, Peter proclaims that he will follow Jesus. The soprano, accompanied by two flutes in unison, joyfully sings to represent Peter's good intentions and, according to Bach's own design, ours as well. I will also follow you with joy in my step. Ich folge dir, I will follow thee with joy. From the St. John Passion by Johann Sebastian Bach, and that was soprano Josefien Stoppelenburg. I'm Ron Klemm, along with Dennis Sparger, music director of the Bach Society of St. Louis, and we're discussing the texts that Bach used in his setting of the St. John Passion. We mentioned the evangelist and the other characters who deliver the gospel narrative. We talked about the Brachus poetry that the soloists sang. But wait, there's more. And this source provides perhaps the greatest connection to the listener. Tell us, Dennis, about the beloved chorales.
Well, this really connects with me as well, since I've spent, you know, almost my entire life working with choirs and choruses. The chorales were known by everyone in Bach's congregation, and many of us still recognize them today. They constitute the third source of texts. Many of these texts are in the first person and were intentionally selected by Bach to reinforce each individual's personal relationship to the Passion story. But the purpose of these familiar chorales is to galvanize or unify the listeners in a common shared experience.
And here's a typical example from part two of Bach's St. John Passion. The Bach Society Chorus and Orchestra, conducted by Dennis Sparger, with a chorale from Bach's St. John Passion. And that makes me want to hear more and to know more about this magnificent work.
Yeah, well, Ron, beginning in 1977, I've studied, prepared, and conducted this work 8 times, plus, of course, the 9th time of preparing it in 2020. And I still want to know more about it. Today, we rarely hear Bach's Passions as part of a Good Friday service, but they are often presented as concerts by groups like the Bach Society, where they still provide opportunities for meditation as well as artistic enjoyment. But most importantly, Bach's Passions call for us to contemplate Christ's sacrifice on the cross for the redemption of mankind.
Well, I'm so glad we are contemplating the St. John Passion in this series of get-togethers. I'm learning a lot, and I'm looking forward to learning more.
Well, great. That's the point of these conversations. I hope we can provide just enough background information to make everyone eager to hear Bach's St. John Passion and to make them more open to connecting with its message.
Excellent. Next time, we'll talk about Bach and the Lutheran liturgy in Leipzig, as well as the performing forces used in the St. John Passion. With Bach Society Music Director Dennis Sparger, this is Ron Klemm. I hope you'll join us again next time for more Bach Talk.
Thank you for joining us for today's Bach Talk. This is part of the 2021 St. Louis Bach Festival, sponsored by Centene Charitable Foundation. I'd like to invite you to stay tuned for a special added attraction, a performance of 2 arias from the St. John Passion by 2 of our favorite soloists, each singer performing on location. Enjoy, and please join us again next time.
Befördere den Lauf und höre Lächter auf, befördere den Thank you.